you can lose it. You can lose it even if you keep out roads, planes, and human occupancy. This quote by Ernest Oberholzer is talking about conserving the land of the boundary waters. This quote is related to unanswered questions that had confronted conservationists like Oberholzer. Christopher C. Andrews. Sigurd Olsen. And Aldo Leopold. These men came to see values in the forest even greater than timber production, recreation, and spiritual renewal. Since its creation in 1909, recreation has always generated more money than timber in the Superior National Forest. Still, the big question was if the region would be dedicated to growing timber or used for recreation. So began the wilderness ethic, the idea that some land should be held in a primeval state.
Preservation of Quetico Superior Country began in 1902 under the leadership of Christopher C. Andrews. Andrews persuaded the Commissioner of the General Land Office to withdraw the sale of 500,000 acres of public domain in northern Minnesota. The lumbermen had passed over this land because it had been severely burned in 1863, 1874, and 1894. The surveyors had reported this land as having little or no value at all. In 1905, Andrews made a canoe trip along the international boundary and was struck by the boundary water's appearance. He wrote, "The islands lend the chief beauty to the scenery. To denude them of timber would be of public injury. For that locality is one of the most important in Minnesota." Christopher Andrews. On Andrews' recommendation, the General Land Office withdrew 141,000 more acres of timber along the Crooked Lake and Lac La Croix. At the same time, Andrews asked the Ontario government to create public forests on its islands and shores along these two lakes. Andrews' proposal for an international forest reserve resulted in the creation of Quetico Park and Superior Forest in 1909.
In the late 1920s, Edward Wellington Backus, an entrepreneur and timber baron, proposed building a series of dams along the international border lakes to generate hydroelectric power. Backus also planned to log the area's shoreline timber. Conservationists led by Ernest Oberholzer opposed Backus's plans and convinced Congress to pass the Shipstead-Newton-Nolan Act, which was signed by President Herbert Hoover. The act withdrew all federal land in the Boundary Waters region from homesteading or sale, prevented the alternation of natural water levels by dams, prohibited logging within 400 feet of shorelines, and preserve the wilderness nature of shorelines. These regulations applied to a 4,000 square mile area extending from Lake Superior on the east to Rainy Lake on the west. The passage of this act signaled a defeat of Edward Wellington Backus's plan.
In 1948, the Federal Service produced a management plan for the roadless area that, for the first time, looked to regulate. Although the Forest Service never issued motorboat regulations, the agency had articulated a management approach that would limit motorboats to routes on which they had become well established. What resulted from this was the Tye-Blatnik Act. This plan also formally established a 362,000-acre no-cut zone along the international border in which logging was prohibited. The act has been extended and funded a couple times since its passing in 1948. The First Amendment to the Tye-Blatnik Act was in 1956, which permitted enlargement of the Boundary Waters canoe area. This was put into effect due to the overuse by the public. The Second Amendment to the Thai Black Act was in 1961, which granted the Forest Service the right to condemn private lands with the BWCA. This act helped to settle a sustained battle that had been waged since 1909 to help preserve this unique wooded lakeland region.
Many acts helped the boundary waters, but maybe the most important was the Wilderness Act. It has helped form the boundary waters into what it is today. This act was effective in 1964 and was sponsored by Minnesota Senator Hubert H. Humphrey. This created the federal wilderness system and further designated and protected the Boundary Waters Canoe Area, and officially named it the Boundary Waters Canoe Area Wilderness, or BWCAW. The act defines wilderness as being designated federal land. It also directed foresters to manage the area first for natural integrity and to preserve the area's long-term ecological process. This act prohibits commercial enterprise and permanent roads within any wilderness areas designated by the act. The act also prohibits the use of motor vehicles, motorized equipment, or motorboats, landing of aircraft and other form of mechanical transport. Section 2A of the Act, passed on September 3rd of 1964, states, "These wilderness areas shall be administrated for the use and enjoyment of the American people in such manner as will leave them unimpaired for future use and enjoyment." Overall, the Wilderness Act stipulates that human activity is not to be visible to the average visitor, that outstanding opportunities for solitude exist, and that visitors have the opportunity to be isolated from the sights, sounds, and presence of other human beings.
Preserving the boundary waters was a big movement in Minnesota history. It was very important to save this wilderness because of its deep history. This vast wilderness has been home to many different tribes, such as the Chippewa. As early as 11,000 years ago, prehistoric Indians first roamed the shores of Lake Agassiz, which, at one time, covered much of northern Minnesota and extended well into Canada. As European influence reached the North Woods, fur trappers and traders harvested a bounty of furs. Voyagers traveled the smaller inland waters in birch bark northern-style canoes approximately 25 feet in length. In present day, hundreds of years later, people can still come up north to be in total silence and cut off from the natural world. Ridding the boundary waters of plains and resorts helped increase the yearly visits from 50,000 in 1953 to 103,000 in 1969, and later on 170,000 in 1976. Because of these important acts, the region was saved and became the most heavily used primitive area in the nation. It was still a place of rare delight, a region apart from the modern world, where men could enjoy the profusion of nature as completely as in the days of Columbus. There was nothing wilder in the jungles of Brazil or in the heart of Africa. It was not a somber forest threaded with sparkling waterways, flooded with sunshine, and peopled with all its ancient creatures. Ernest Oberholzer.